It's a real pleasure for me to present work that I've done in collaboration with many people here at the group, a former group at Caltech, doing simulations of core collapse supernovae. This is work that has been done in collaboration especially with Philip Moster, with Christian Ott, and also with Eric Schnetter, Roland Haas, and Luke Roberts. So today I'm going to talk about a recent discovery that we have made thanks to blue water of a turbulent dynamo and rotating magnetized core collapse supernovae. So let me start by reminding all what core collapse supernovae is and why we think that they are interesting objects to study and what we are trying to achieve here. Core collapse supernovae represent basically the end stage of evolution of massive stars. When the stars, they exhaust their nuclear fuel, they undergo collapse and they explode as supernovae. And here are a few numbers about supernovae. There is roughly one every 50 years in a galaxy like our own. We are actually long due for a galactic supernovae. And if you account for all of the galaxies in the observable universe, this sums up to a huge number, orders of tens every second in the observable universe, core collapse supernovae. Of this, we observe roughly a few every day thanks to surveys. They have a peak luminosity which is roughly 10 to 10 times that of our sun. So at peak luminosity, they shine like an entire galaxy, 10 billion stars. Their energy is roughly distributed like this. Most of the energy goes into neutrinos. This is 10 to the 53 ergs of energy that's liberated by supernovae. Most of it goes into neutrinos. 1% of this goes into kinetic energy. So this is energy that's put in the envelope of the star that starts expanding rapidly. And a small fraction of this, less than 1%, is what we actually observe at the end, this 10 to the 48 ergs in electromagnetic radiation. So here I would like to remind you a little bit about core collapse supernovae before actually going into the main topic. So as you probably all know very well, stars counteract the gravitational pull by burning nuclear fuel. For example, our sun burns hydrogen into helium. This liberates energies that counterbalance gravity, so the star is in quasi-equilibrium. Massive stars, stars that are more massive than our sun by a factor of 8 or so, more, burn hydrogen very quickly within a few tens of millions of years, and then they start burning helium, and then carbon, oxygen, heavier and heavier elements. The latest stage of evolution of a star is when it starts burning silicon. This is the last few days of burning. So you can imagine that a star like our sun burns one solar mass of hydrogen over billions of years. Here, massive stars burn silicon, roughly one solar mass of silicon within few days before exploding. When silicon burns, the ashes of this burning are iron. And iron is the element with the heaviest nuclear binding energy. This means that you cannot produce energy by burning hydrogen, by doing nuclear fusion of, nuclear fusion of iron. So you start to form a massive core at the center of the star, a massive iron core. When this core reaches a critical mass, which is roughly 1.4 solar masses, actually a bit less than that, it becomes gravitationally unstable because of different reasons. When this happens, the core shrinks from a size, roughly the size of our planet, to a size of a sphere of a radius around 40 kilometers. This happens within a few tens milliseconds. So the core collapses very rapidly. The central density reaches nuclear density. At that point, the nuclear equation of state becomes really stiff because you have the saturation of nuclear forces. And the inner part of the core stalls because of this repulsive force appearing all of a sudden. So the interesting thing now is that the inner part of the core unfolds subsonically. This means that the inner part is all in sonic contact, while the outer part is unfolding supersonically. So when the inner part stops collapsing, the outer part doesn't know that anything has happened. And as a result, it basically slams into the into the stalled core, which is a proton-neutron star, so an object that is going to become a neutron star. And this launches a shockwave that travels outward. The shockwave eventually stalls because it loses energy dissociating heavy nuclei. So there is accretion of iron group nuclei through the shockwave. The temperatures are really high, and all of these nuclei gets dissociated into nucleons, neutrons and protons. and alpha particles. This rubs the shock by a lot of its energy, so it eventually stalls. At this point, we think that something happens to revive the shock. In most cases, this is thought to be neutrinos. If you remember, almost all of the energy of core collapse supernova, all of the energy that you have liberated by contracting the core, all of this gravitational energy goes into neutrinos, 99% of it. If you can absorb 1% of this energy in this region behind the shock wave, this is enough to trigger an explosion. So this is what we think is happening in most cases. And when you do this, the shock revives, starts to expand outwards. As it does so, it also synthesizes radioactive elements like nickel. And so the radioactive decay of these elements that then powers the supernova electromagnetic emission that we observe with our telescopes. And eventually, this energy is enough to unbind the outer envelope of the stars. And these are basically the garden variety of supernova type, the general type 2 supernovae. However, for the purpose of this work, we are interested in a very peculiar class of supernovae that are extreme. So supernova are very extreme events by themselves, but there is a subclass of supernova which is even more extreme. And they come in three varieties. They're all extreme. One is superluminous supernovae. These are supernovae that are up to 100 times or more, well, at least 100 times more luminous than normal supernovae. So these are as luminous as hundreds of galaxies. And it's very difficult to explain this only by this traditional scenario. Another class is so-called hypernovae. These are not exactly the same as supernovae. These are supernovae that have very high energy in their eject, 10 times or more the normal energy that you have in supernovae. Another class of events that are associated with supernovae is long gamma ray burst. And these are high energy emission that we think originate by relativistic outflows. So at the end of a supernova, somehow you form a rapidly rotating black hole, and you generate relativistic jets, at least in a very small percentage of supernovae. And this powers what we think are gamma ray bursts. It's very difficult to explain any of these observations, any of this class of phenomena, just from the standard supernova mechanism I just illustrated. Especially hypernovae and gamma ray bursts are really, really require additional physics that is just not there in traditional supernovae. It's really impossible to extract 10 to the 52 ergs of energy from the neutrinos. So the bottom line is you need some other energy source to power these objects. It cannot be neutrinos. So what theoreticians have long proposed is that this additional energy is actually a rotational energy. There is a small percentage of stars that are thought to have very fast rotation just before they collapse. And if you somehow are able to create, after the collapse, an object that spins, proton-neutron star that spins with a period of roughly 1 millisecond, so comparable to the fastest known rotating neutron stars, then the amount of energy that you store in the rotation is a few times 10 to the 52 ergs. So this is enough to explain hypernovae. So if you have a mechanism to extract this rotation, you can explain this class of very energetic event. And the way in which we think that this happens is by large-scale magnetic fields. So if you have strong enough magnetic fields, you are able to tap this energy and transfer it from rotation into kinetic energy by powering basically magnetically driven jets. This is something that has been verified to work already in the early, well, in the mid-2000s by Adam Boros and collaborator in 2D, and more recently by my collaborators also in 3D. And basically the picture that emerges is if you have strong enough magnetic field and fast rotation, you can create the kind of asymmetric explosion that you need to create in order to explain hypernovae. What you need is, as I said, fast rotation and strong magnetic field. At the end, if the end state of the supernova is a stable remnant, so if the proton-neutron star basically condenses down to a neutron star, then the additional energy provided by the magnetic braking can explain superluminous supernovae. Or otherwise, if you form a black hole, which is an alternative path of evolution, then the jet launched by the black hole later in the explosion is what we think can power long gamma ray burst. So all is well in the theory, but the question is, does it really work? So do we really get this kind of conditions in nature. And the key open question is whether you can actually create the kind of magnetic fields that you need, because getting 1 millisecond rotation period seems to be achievable, at least according to our understanding of stellar evolution. The really difficult thing is getting the kind of magnetic fields that you need. You need a field of the order of 10 to the 15 or 10 to the 16 Gauss. Just to give you an idea, 10 to the 4 Gauss is roughly 1 Tesla, if you are used to thinking SI units. We think that the pre-collapse supernova fields are roughly 10 to the 9 Gauss in the most extreme cases. So if you have stronger magnetic fields, then you will slow down the star by magnetic braking, and you will not be able to produce hypernovae. And just by flux freezing, so just by compressing the field during the collapse of the iron core, you get a factor 10 to the 3 of amplification. The open question is how you get the other 10 to the 4 amplification factor that you need to power hypernovae. And again, of course, theory has a possible answer, and the answer is in the so-called magneto-rotational instability. This is an instability that has been already studied for many years in the context of accretion disks as a known instability of shearing magnetized flows. So every time you have a magnetized flow with shear and even a very weak poloidal magnetic field, you are unstable to this instability. This is often the fastest growing instability that you find in magneto-hydrodynamical flows. And a simple cartoon for how it works is the one that I've taken here from Google Images. So basically here, this is, shows a mechanical analog of this instability. You can think of field lines connecting two fluid elements as basically being a spring. Their linear response of the spring is identical from a mathematical point of view to the Alphen waves. So this is an instability of Alphen waves, of magnetoelastic waves. So what happens is, if you have differential rotation, this blue guy here is going to rotate faster than the red fluid element. And as a result, you will start stretching the magnetic field. The magnetic field will back react and transport angular momentum from this fluid element to this one. And as a result, this fluid element will sink even more because it loses angular momentum. And as it sinks, since this is a differentially rotating structure, it actually starts to spin up even more. So you have a runaway situation where you exponentially amplify magnetic field, at least in this simple mechanical analog. We know that this instability is active in supernovae. This is also something that has been known for more than 10 years. And here I show basically two plots showing the instability criterion in the region surrounding the proton-neutron star a few milliseconds after bounce. So here, this blue region where basically nothing is happening, this is the proton-neutron star. It collapsed, is the inner part of the iron core has collapsed and stalled. And here there is a strong shear flow around. And we find that there are unstable wave modes with wavelength of the order of half kilometer or so, and with very fast time scale. So this instability has a time scale of less than 1 millisecond, with typical growth rate of half millisecond. So in half millisecond, you have one folding growth of the magnetic field, if this instability actually take place. And we know for local simulations, so these are simulations that have been done just by considering a very tiny patch of the star in a very idealized setting and looking at what happens, that this instability is very efficient at growing magnetic field. I show here results from a recent paper by the Valencia group. And you can show, you can see here the toroidal magnetic field, color-coded, and a growth rate of the magnetic energy. These are all local simulations, but they show very nicely that you can grow the magnetic energy by 10 order of magnitude in 10 milliseconds. This structure that you see here, this pattern red, blue, this is a so-called channel flows. And the wavelength, the most unstable wavelength of the MRI is basically given by these channel modes. In local simulations, we know that in 2D, this instability is perfect. It basically grows the magnetic field until the code crashes. There is no way to stop it. In 3D, what happens is that these channel flows become unstable to secondary instability, so you form current sheets that are unstable to tiering mode or because of Kelvin-Helmholtz instabilities, and these are shown in these red dots. And when these instability, secondary instabilities reach large scale, then the MRI terminates. So all is well, at least in local simulation. The question is, does it really work if you take a non-idealized setting? So if you take a real supernova, not just a small patch of the fluid. And most importantly, can you create net flux? When this instability is studied in the context of accretion disk, what people really want to have is a way to explain the way you transfer angular momentum. But what we want here is to produce large-scale net poloidal flux, because this is what we need to power explosions. So we needed global simulations. And this is what we have performed here. The kind of simulations we need are relatively complex and expensive, and this is why it took so many years for us to get to the point of being able to do these simulations, because we needed to include the relativistic magneto-hydrodynamics. You have speeds comparable to the speed of light, you have relativistic gravity. You have to include neutrino radiation, and most important, you need extremely high resolutions. Resolving these length scales require resolutions that are a factor 7 higher than the highest resolution ever performed before in this, for this problem, which translates to an increase of a factor 3,000 in computational cost if you take into account the CFL. In order to tackle this problem, we had to really simplify everything to the point that we could. So what we did is we started from a lower resolution simulation that we evolved until the point of core bounds. We consider only a small domain because we are interested in the growth phase of the MRI, which lasts only 10 milliseconds. So this region here around the proton-neutron star is causally disconnected from the boundary within these 10 milliseconds. We had to use uniform grids because our code couldn't scale to the level required for these simulations with AMR. And we had to freeze the space-time evolution. So here we consider gravity as basically given. A lot of work went into minimizing MPI communications and removing a lot of synchronization that is there in our code to work with AMR and GR. This is work that Philip has done and took him a lot of time. We use the publicly available code, which we are developing and that's freely available to download for everybody. It's called the Einstein Toolkit. And it's a collaborative project that involves many institutions. It also is basically the only publicly available generativistic magneto-hydrodynamic code, which includes realistic microphysics, so nuclear equation of state and neutrinos. And the other key ingredients also of this project was, of course, using blue waters, because we really needed access to sustained petascale resources. The simulation we performed used 130,000 cores and needed 7 million CPU node hours just to study these 10 milliseconds of evolution. And it produces 500 terabytes of output. I should also mention that the data that we produced is going to be public soon. And we are still figuring out the details of this, but stay tuned for that. I will just show very briefly the results that we get for the highest resolution case. And here what I show is the strength of the toroidal field again. Bright color is strong magnetic field, and dark color is weak magnetic field. You can see the shear flows as it rotates around the proton-neutron star, which is basically this region here where nothing is happening because it's not unstable to the MRI. But in the region around, we quickly form very patches of very strong magnetic fields. And we also observe the appearance of large-scale structures, especially in these polar regions, where magnetic field seems to be growing at large scales. And this is exactly what we are hoping to find, because this means that the MRI not only amplifies the magnetic field, which is something we already knew from linear theory and from local simulations, but creates the kind of magnetic fields we need to explain hypernovae. And just to be a little bit more quantitative, I show here a plot of the magnetic energy at different wave numbers and as a function of time. So this is the magnetic energy spectrum. Basically, it tells you how much energy is at a given scale. And you can see here for different times. At early time, we start from a low resolution simulation, so there is nothing at high wave number. At small scale, there is nothing because it's beyond the Nyquist frequency of the grid. Then after we remap the simulation to higher resolution, we observe very fast growth within 1 millisecond of the magnetic field at the wave number that's predicted by the theory. So at this wave number around 20 or so, within 1 millisecond it saturates. And then over longer time scales, we observe transfer of magnetic energy to larger scale. And this for us is a very strong indication that there is something going on which is either a dynamo or an inverse cascade in MHD turbulence. The same thing is shown here where I show the growth rate for different wave wave numbers as a function of time. Again, you see that at small scale, everything is done within a few milliseconds. And at large scale, we have a secular growth, which continues beyond the end of our simulation. If we extrapolate this growth, for example, for the k equal 4 mode, we find that within a 20 or 30 milliseconds, the magnetic field will be comparable to the kinetic energy in the fluid at these scales. So this means that even if you start with weak magnetic fields, as we have done here for the first time, you actually reach a regime where the magnetic field is comparable to the kinetic energy. So it becomes dynamically important. And this also justifies previous simulations that use artificially high magnetic fields to begin with because they couldn't resolve the magneto-rotational instability. So here are my conclusions. We find that the MRI, the magneto-rotational instability, provides explosive growth of the magnetic field. Core collapse supernovae, when you have fast rotations, are always magnetized. Even if you start with a very weak magnetic field, the theory tells you that very quickly you become magnetically dominated, especially around the poles of the proton-neutron star. We find very strong evidences that there is a dynamo action. So you not just create small passes of randomly oriented magnetic field that's prone to reconnection, but you create large-scale flux. And the final conclusion is all of this was possible only because we had access to beta scale resources. This would have been impossible only a few years ago. And this is all I wanted to say. Thank you.